Ready? I don't know what this is. I have no
idea.
Oh,
no. I was just, you know, game thing.
Flappily.
Hello! Guys. Long time no see.
Oh, much too long.
Literally.
But here we are. Yes.
We're back! It's been a while because we've been
extremely busy with so many things.
And also exhausted because life is exhausting.
Out of our minds. But here we are.
But we're back! Just in time for the holidays.
Oh, that's right.
As you can see, the show.
I punned that in my head as holiday.
I mean, he's not wrong. Today we're here because we're doing a book haul. It's like a combined end of October, all of November, slightly beginning of December book haul, because there are a lot of books in this one, just because it's been quite some time. Yes, yes, I'm the guilty part. We've already established that I am the one who buys a lot of books in this family. Mostly because his are on Kindle and you'll never see them.
In physical form.
In physical form.
For the most part.
Yes.
Unless they're Cassandra Clare books. More on that later. Anyone else Shadowhunter trash recently? Because like, I need help. Does it count if I haven't even read
the entire thing and I think I'm Shadowhunter's trash?
Because that's a huge problem.
That's like the preemptive Shadowhunter's trash thing.
But we overstep our bounds and get ahead of ourselves. For now,
we're going to start by sharing all of the books that the lovely and generous people who work at the different publishing houses have sent us.
We love you all.
Yes, you guys are so generous and amazing, and honestly, I am so spoiled.
I had been planning to buy a copy of Berserker. We got this in the mail recently. Berserker is a story about a girl who has the Berserker kind of family line gene. Bloodline limit, but for the non-Naruto fans, it's in her blood that she's a berserker from Viking ages of old. She immigrates to the US in like the olden timey, 1883.
I forgot that this one was 1883.
Which is so weird because it's Vikings meet cowboys, which is
nothing wrong with that.
Refreshing as all heck. And it centers on a young girl who encounters this power and how she wants to survive and protect her family. So I thoroughly enjoyed this. Cannot wait for the second book to come out. Emmy Laybourne, you rock. Next one would be Five.
Such a pretty book.
It is gorgeous. 5 feet under. 5 feet apart, yeah, because that's how it works when you learn how to read. This seems to be part of the cichlid genre. If you notice, like the cleverly kind of developed kind of trees, but they're actually lungs, kind of.
Which is really there. Cool. It's such a pretty cover.
All right, and for the first time, I feel the weight of every single inch, every single millimeter of the 6 feet between us. I pull my sweatshirt closer to my body, trying to ignore the fact that, open space, it'll always be there. Wow, that's. Already.
It's going to be a movie in 2019, and Cole Sprouse is one of the leads in it, so that's all I know about it, aside from the fact that it's...
And who doesn't love the Sprouses? Okay, the next one is I'm Okay by Patty Kim.
That is such a cute cover.
I know, it's basically one of those coming-of-age tales. Okay Lee is certain of it. With his father gone and his mother working 3 jobs but barely making ends meet, Okay feels it's up to him to pay the bills, if only give him the cash prize at school. So yeah, again, coming-of-age tale, obviously that falls to me. This one's also cute, it's called Blended. Most likely, again, another coming-of-age drama. Most likely because there's probably a blended family involved
here. That's what I'm thinking.
So very interesting to see that. Again, at the back, am I black or white? So that's a reality that is absolutely real. And to be sort of in between worlds in that sense is obviously going to prove for a lot of important pathos. I want to say this is Lou. It's by Jason Reynolds.
Sometimes you gotta jump anyway.
Lou was born to be co-captain of the Defenders. Actually he was born albino. That's got nothing to do with being a track star. Okay, there you go. Coming of age tale. Again, this time with, albinism sort of woven into this. So we'll see how this turns out. For those of you who don't know or have trolled Alexa's blog from ages of yore, one of the first books I'd ever read was in cichlid. Before I Die by Jenny Downham.
Which you love.
Which I love so much. And then they made a Dakota Fanning movie called Now Was Good, which I sobbed hysterically to. And then The Fault in Our Stars, which I am known for. Not by you, obviously, but in my circle. So weird. In my personal life and the friends that I have, the stories we could tell you about how much I love that movie. But anyway, but say here, the girl with a broken heart. I really want to put myself through even more harrowing emotional?
I don't know, do you? She has a weak heart. Yeah.
Literal, because cichlid, totally my thing. Moving a little bit onto some kind of sci-fi fantasy-ish, Dark Mind Rising by Julia Keller came into the mail. It's a dark intercept novel. This is a second book, so I might have to troll the library for the first one. Apparently, it is set in 2296, 2 years after the destruction of a universal surveillance system called The Intercept. New Earth struggles to keep crime under control. The citizens are free, but not protected. So that sounds like fun. I'm very excited about City of Broken Magic by Mira Bolander. If it's magic, which wire do you cut? 500 years ago, Magi created a weapon they couldn't control, an infestation that ate magic and anything else it came in contact with. Enemies and allies were equally filling. Only an elite team of non-magical humans known as sweepers can defuse and dispose. So yeah, so it's basically like a bomb squad meets like magical...
That's it, a magical bomb squad. That's
magical bomb
was,
squad. I am so excited for this one in particular. So that rounds up the lovely publishers. Haul that would go to me.
Okay, so my turn. I had a lot of books come in over the last couple of months, just because, you know, it's the season apparently. So one of the first things that I got in the mail was this pair of books. This is Forest of a Thousand Lanterns and this is Kingdom of the Blazing Phoenix, and both are part of the Rise of the Emperor series by Julie C. Dow. This book came out last year and it is basically an origin story for the Evil Queen, but with an East Asian setting. And this is a companion novel that happens a decade later, I want to say. And it's about Princess Jade, who is basically a Snow White character, again, set in the same East Asian inspired world. And both are excellent. This is the perfect book if you like reading about Slytherin characters, because you get to see how this Empress gets her position from using underhanded means, is what I want to say.
Ambition.
And this one is about Princess Jade, who is pretty much the complete opposite of her stepmother, and she sets out on a quest in order to retrieve something that is going to help save her kingdom. And both are absolutely brilliant, so thank you so much, Penguin, for sending these along to me. Next from Tor is a book that I technically can't tell you what it's about because I actually haven't read the first book yet in this series, and this is like book three, I want to say. It's Holy Sister by Mark Lawrence. This is the third book of the Ancestor series. I think the first book is Red Sister, which I actually do have on my TBR. Just haven't read it yet. It has girls who are trained to be assassins in it, and I am literally a sucker for just that one element in any fantasy story, so obviously...
We love our assassins in this family.
Clearly.
Approachable or otherwise.
This is the third book in that series. I am very much looking forward to reading the first one. I know Kristen has read it from Super Space Chick, and she really enjoyed it. Next is a book that I got from St. Martin's Griffin, and this is Care of My Friend DJ, and it's a book called Red, White, and Royal Blue. All you really need to know about this is that it is about a prince and the son of the president and a budding romance, and that's all I really care about anyway. From HMH Teen, and they sent me an advanced reading copy of Courting Darkness by Robin Lefevers. So you remember how we were just talking about like assassins? Yeah, this is set in the same world as her His Fair Assassin trilogy, which is about assassin nuns. And I love it.
All right.
This is from Holiday House. It's another pair of books. We have Kingdom of Ash and Briars and Realm of Ruins, both by Hannah West. These are companion novels to each other, I think. This one just came out recently. I have not read either, but I have heard that they're sort of fairy tale inspired, which obviously, again, another thing that I am in for. Plus, look how pretty they are.
They are gorgeous.
They are my aesthetic, basically.
That's
true.
They
also match Maki's, like,
interestingly enough,
today. We have Undying, which is the sequel to last year's... Oh my gosh, what's the first? Oh, Unearthed. Unearthed was basically Indiana Jones set in space. And this is by Amy Kaufman and Megan Spooner, and I'm so excited to have the sequel in my hands. I quite enjoyed the first book last year. I feel like I need to reread it to refresh my brain on all of the details before I dive into this one, but I cannot wait, so thank you so much, Disney Books, for sending this to me. Next, we have something from Simon & Schuster, and that is a finished copy of This Cruel Design by Emily Suvada. This is the second book in her series. The first is This Mortal Coil, and it is basically a sci-fi story where there is, I think it has something to do with genetics.
Genetic manipulation.
Right? Yeah, genetic manipulation. Like I know that Kristen really liked the first book, This Mortal Coil, so I'm looking forward to reading that one and this one, so thank you, Simon & Schuster. I got some boxes.
Box number one.
First is Little White Lies, which you can see. I really like this box. I got an invitation to go to a debutante ball. And the person that is getting presented is the main character of this book, Sawyer.
Handwritten.
We have sweet tea and this mason jar that says, sweet as sugar. We also have this keychain. One side says Little White Lies, the other side says Bless Your Heart, because you know.
One can never have enough mason jars.
But my favorite thing that was in this, that is not the book, obviously, are these coasters.
What do they say?
Court coasters. So one says, never trust a debutante. And then another one says, sweet as sugar. And then we have Hey Y'all, which reminds me of my friend Hannah from So Obsessed With. And the last one, Bless Your Heart. We have a finished copy of Little White Lies by Jennifer Lynn Barnes, which I have not yet read, but it is essentially about Sawyer, who is contacted by her grandmother and told that she will be paid to be presented to society, but also she has something to solve while she's there, so Sounds like an interesting mix of things, and I can't wait to get to it. The next box is for Four Dead Queens. So there was this letter that was in the box. You guys can't really see what it says, but it is basically a letter from one of the queens. There's a ring in this box. Also, ooh, you guys are probably not gonna be able to see it because it's kind of tiny, but it's there. We also have these character cards for the four queens. So we have Cora, Marguerite,
Marguerite,
Stessa, who the letter is from, and Iris. So those are the four queens.
Those are awesome.
And last but not least, we have an arc of Four Dead Queens by Astrid. Okay, I'm gonna butcher that last name. Maybe you should try it.
Four Dead Queens by Astrid Schultz.
The two main characters in this book are Carolee and Varin, and their paths cross because Carolee is actually one of the best thieves, and Varin is an upstanding citizen, but his path ends up crossing with hers when she tries to steal something from him. But they end up having to work together when they get entangled in a conspiracy that leaves the four queens, which we've shown you, in for each of the quadrants, dead. And wow, so they have to figure things out together, and it sounds really great, and I'm so excited to read it. So the last box I have to show you is the Shell Queens box, which I got from Simon and Schuster, Riveted Lift, basically. So there is a card that basically tells you what's in it. There were two pins that say Shelf Queen, but there were basically five books in this one. So we're gonna start with Slayer by Kirsten White. It's set in the world of Buffy the Vampire Slayer. It is about Nina and her twin Artemis, and they basically go to like an academy, the Watchers Academy.
So this is probably set right after Buffy season 7, maybe somewhere in between the comics when a Slayer Academy was actually established.
And essentially the entire plot revolves around the fact that Nina is discovered to be the very last Slayer. Next we have Girls with Sharp Sticks by Suzanne Young, which has this very perfect cover. The tagline says, some of the prettiest flowers have the sharpest thorns. I don't know anything about this one, but my friend Andy from Andy's ABCs loved this book, and I'm so looking forward to reading it. Next we have Kind of a Massive Book, and it's Sky Without Stars by Jessica Brody and Joanne Rendell. Basically, I have been told that this is Les Miserables, but in space. So that is like a very ambitious comparison for me. It'll be interesting to see how these authors
I'm imagining Javert walking into the Imperial March.
And then we have The Cold is in Her Bones by Peter Nell Van Arsdale. And the only thing I know about this one is that it is about a Medusa type character. Or it's about Medusa herself. I don't actually know that much. And last but not least, and obviously the one that I was most excited about in this box, Crown of Feathers by Nikki Pau-Preto. And the reason why I was so excited, I mean, come on, it's a Phoenix fantasy book. I mean, give me the... Plus, it also has something to do with sisters. So, I'm a sucker for fantasies, or any story really, that has a sister aspect to it. But also, I got the major bonus of Phoenixes in this book, so that's really all
What's
I needed to know.
To
like, I didn't really care what else it was about. I'm very much looking forward to this, and hopefully I love it as much as I think I will. So we totally forgot that Maki actually has a box to unbox.
It came for Alexa, but this is relic now of our childhood. Well, it's a relic of my childhood.
Yours and my sister Mel's. I haven't actually ever read it, and I really want to before the movie comes
out. Okay, so caveat, even if I seem to sway towards Faye, yes, that rhymes. Artemis Fowl. You would think that I wouldn't like this because of all of the fairy involvement, but we got an Artemis Fowl box because I know they're relaunching it with the book and everything. And so, here's what we find in this really cool box. We have a backpack. It says, Artemis Fowl, so smart, it's criminal. Well, yes. So good job taglining that, Disney. There are a bunch of cards here that tells you, you know, kind of what's in here. Ooh, and they are redesigning the book covers, and there is a schedule for the redesigns. October 2 for Artemis Fowl, the Arctic Innocent. November 6th for the Eternity Code and the Opal Deception. November 4th for the Lost Colony and the Time Paradox.
January
8th for the Atlantis Complex and the Last Guardian. And June 25th, the Artemis Fowl movie tie-in edition.
How
so
exciting.
I had all of these books kind of growing up. So exciting for that. Ooh, Artemis Fowl Fidget Spinner. I can already imagine Artemis thinking of what he thinks of these.
It says, trust me,
I'm a genius. So many things.
I like how you're like,
oh, we have a LEP unit. Yes, the Lower Elements Protection, or
That's
Lower Elements Police.
For?
Yeah, LEP Recon. Lower Elements Police Reconnaissance.
Oh, I can't wait to read this book. How's it look?
Looks great.
I don't even know what it means.
The hat of your people. So, and in the box, we have two soft covers, which we will save for last because I think there is some candy in here or some such.
You'll always get Mackie if you got candy in there.
I forget if there's any significance to the story, but I do know that the Artemis Fowl books had the fairy language sort of printed out at the bottom of every single page.
That's cool.
And you could actually,
they
absolutely would. You could actually decode the message in the book with the decoder on the back.
Oh, so that's cool.
These are the two soft-bound books that have come in. I think these are
the redesigns.
So we have Artemis Fowl, which is the first book. I don't know if Artemis is just kind of like a precocious child, because at 11, I don't know if you're this tall and gangly, but hey, maybe that's his thing. Well, 12 anyway. And then part two is the Arctic incident.
It's so pretty. I really like those colors.
This is the most awesome I've ever seen. Not that I've seen a lot of art for Holly Short, but yeah, fairies are cool apparently. And
I wonder if they did keep that out.
Yeah, they did. And so I don't know if they kept the fairy language at the back.
But this is a great way
to jumpstart their collection again. I had to wait months and years on end to get all of the.
Meanwhile, of those books. I get to binge. Jamie!
She gets to binge in that sense. They're easy reads. Plus, Artemis Fowl is right up your alley because he is a stuck-up, snobbish, self-important genius.
Oh, sounds like Damian Wayne. So those are all the things that we got from publishers, which we are eternally grateful for. I will link to the trailer, or the little teaser trailer that was released for Artemis Fowl, because that was really exciting.
Indeed. And now we move on to the things that we had purchased with our own money.
Own cold hard cash. I really need to like slow my roll.
I will start with a very good deal I got on eBay. Because I do that. I was hankering for kind of jump-starting my Fables collection.
And we had talked about it too.
This is the graphic novel collection written by Bill Willingham. Yeah, and with a bunch of other kind of artists and writers over time. And I was able to get a really good deal on the first 6 graphic novels.
How many are there even?
Yeah, I want to say 20-ish. Of Fables. For those of you who don't know, Fables is one of the most creative, I want to say, use of what everybody else knows as regular kind of fable canon. It's Snow White, Cinderella, Sleeping Beauty, all woven into some place. It's set in New York City, where fables from the Fable Lands, or I forget what they're called, have taken refuge and have created like a little kind of tiny niche where the Big Bad Wolf is the sheriff.
Yeah.
Snow White is the DA or whatever, is a district attorney.
Yeah. No, she's not.
Vice mayor or something. And then you've got Old King Cole as the mayor. And shenanigans sort of ensued because there are rules. They're supposed to keep away from the mundane world. And
isn't that always the case?
And you think first book starts off in like a murder, like who murdered?
Yeah, that's
Jack,
the entire premise. Mm-hmm.
Jack being able to jack be quick. Every single Jack was that dude. And who murdered him, we wonder. It's a caper. So you would think it would be an excuse to just kind of make like a what if Fables were in a grown-up setting. For those of you who are familiar with the PlayStation game The Wolf Among Us, this is that world. It's a great series. I highly recommend it to anybody who's looking for something fresh.
Because I've only got it
to this day, it's absolutely fresh.
Second one?
Well, now you've got 3, 4, 5, and 6.
I know.
Readily available. And at the top of my collection of things that I absolutely consider my shipment of win for the last few... What I'm holding in my hands is everything that came out for the newest, I want to say, edition of the Dungeons & Dragons canon.
Yeah, I think it's like the 5th, 6th?
Well, yeah, this is the 5th edition, but this is the newest kind of story that they put out. What they had done is they had combined lore for Magic the Gathering, which is a very popular card game, and put it into a Dungeons & Dragons setting, specifically Ravnica. So this is the Guildmaster's Guide to Ravnica. They released maps and miscellany along with it, which are just gorgeous, gorgeous. Like maps of the districts of Ravnica with like dungeons and information cards on kind of what's
That's
going
amazing.
On. They're just lovely, lovely tools.
Don't worry, Kristen and Andrew, at some point this is going to come.
This is definitely, and we've been playing Dungeons and Dragons with Super Space Chick, Kristen and her husband Andrew.
Team Silver Space,
there you go. And it even came with its own set of dice. Now what I love about this dice
stuff
is it has all of the Dungeons and Dragons dice that you'll need, all the different polyhedral dices that come along together. Did I just say dices?
Dice.
I did, whatever. Dice, it's like sheep, whatever, plural. I cannot English today. But what's cool is this collector's tin actually has embossed all of the symbols of the guilds of Ravnica, which, for those of you who play Magic the Gathering, it's about, magic comes in 5 elements with different kind of personalities and what have you. For the first time in Ravnica, which was so groundbreaking when it came out for that game, was they started combining colors on purpose, not just like for fun, but just like really, that's how the world is. Every guild is like a combination of 2 colors and their sort of combined proclivities. The best part of the dice would have to be the guild dice. So it's a 10-sided die, but each one has like the guild symbol in there. So just think of the 5 colors, slap them together in certain orders, and you get it. I will probably want to vlog about all the the coolness of this, but
we will.
In the interest of time.
At some point, we'll probably do a Dungeon Master. We'll have to do a D&D one.
This is the crowning achievement of my entire career as a Dungeon Master.
Duly noted.
And as a geek. I love that because I loved Ravnica. I love the story. In fact, part of the haul is I actually bought the Ravnica books that came out. This Dungeons & Dragons thing had been set long after the first events of Ravnica. I bought the first books, so we will flash them here. These tell the story of Ravnica and how it's all started out, and I had already finished one. Can't wait to reread the other two.
It is now my turn to talk about the books that I bought, barring a couple that I will share later. So, first, I finally got a finished copy of Girls of Paper and Fire by Natasha Ngan. This is the Barnes & Noble exclusive edition because there is an annotated scene.
I love
that. Also,
those.
Can we just take a moment to appreciate that this cover is red, the actual
pretty.
Cover is more plummy, and then it has the symbol on it.
Plummy goodness. Sorry, it's been a long day.
This YA fantasy is the first in a new series. It's about a girl named Lei who is chosen as one of the king's paper girls. So basically, they are trained and brought up in the palace to, you know, cater to his every need. And when I say every need, I mean every need. And while she's there,
some mani-pedis then. No, right then.
I wish it were as innocent as that.
That's my idea of being king. Somebody doing my nails. That's right.
Anyway, while Lei's there, she meets the other girl, she uncovers the fact that there are a couple of brewing conspiracies within the palace, and she also learns to navigate with her own, you know, abilities and know-how. And she also falls in love, but it's a forbidden romance. So it is a combination of a lot of different things that I really enjoyed in this one, and I am so looking forward to the second book. The next book is actually one I also mentioned earlier, but this is a finished copy of that book. Kingdom of the Blazing Phoenix by Julie C. Dow. This is the finished copy of the book. Next is a book that I just wanted a hardcover copy of for my shelves. I got this one on Abe Books, I want to say, and it's this particular edition of The Night Circus by Aaron Morgenstern. And the reason I wanted this edition in particular is because,
ooh,
first of all,
pretty.
Clock. Second of all, it actually has black stained pages. And third of all, it also has this bookmarker in it.
Nice.
The Night Circus is about two rival magicians, and they constantly are competing in this circus. And you watch the story unfold, and you kind of start learning the origins of that rivalry and like what it means for them and towards the end of the story. And it is a very slow burn kind of story where you have to keep going until you finally realize you're in the thick of it and can't escape. So it's great. Next we have Grave Mercy by Robin Lefebvre. This is the first in the His Fair Assassin trilogy, which I mentioned earlier.
Ah, yes.
This one in particular is about Isbay, and she escapes from an arranged marriage and goes to this convent where she learns how to be an assassin for death, because why not? She ends up being planted in the court eventually, and so she has to maneuver all of the intrigue over there. And I haven't read this one in a while, but I remember really enjoying it.
So in learning to be an assassin for death, does it make you an assassin for life?
Next is a very pretty collector's edition that I'm very happy to have, and it is for Six of Crows by Leigh Bardugo.
Hooray!
This is right now my favorite Leigh Bardugo book. It is essentially about six individuals who find themselves brought together when they have to complete this heist. And it is so good. I just really enjoy this group of characters. I really enjoyed the story. I think Leigh Bardugo did an amazing job writing this heist, but also writing out these individual character arcs. And it's so good. I'm secretly hoping that they're gonna do the same sort of edition for the second book in the series as well. So it's got this beautiful like cover. The back says, "No mourners, no funerals," which if you've read it, you know why. Has red stained pages, and it also has,
ooh, a map.
Pretty map as the end paper, ooh. There. It's got some amazing Kevin Wada illustrations. I'm pretty sure it's Kevin Wada right here.
Oh, those are gorgeous.
Of the characters who I love. Yeah, it's just a beautiful book, and I'm so excited to add it to my collection.
I have to read these.
The next is like a really random thing that we found when we went to Costco. It's another edition of The Secret Garden
at
by
Costco.
Frances Hodgson Burnett. I mean,
who knew?
I just really like the fact that it's got a key, and this is more like a younger, like an edition geared towards younger readers. So it has more illustrations in it. Obviously, the story is a little more like, I guess it might be a bridge.
The hope is that our future children would appreciate Frances Hodgson Burnett as
I
much
hope
as
so.
We did.
So the next book is a book I bought at the Strand, and it's The Darkest Part of the Forest by Holly Black. Now, I don't read a lot of fae books. That's probably going to change, let's be real, because most of the people I know love fae books, and they end up telling
don't.
Me. It depends on the kind of fae, really. I enjoyed Holly's fae in her series, Folk of the Air, and I really wanted to read more of her stuff, so I decided to pick up a copy of The Darkest Part of the Forest. I have been told there are characters that I will recognize from that series that appear in this one, so looking forward to that. Next, which I probably should have done earlier, I also picked up Dark Triumph by Robin Lefevre at the Strand. This is the second book in the His Fair Assassin trilogy, and it also has my favorite main character, Sibella, in it. And she infiltrates a particular household to complete her mission in this one, and it's really good, and I now just want to reread it, so probably gonna do that at some point. So,
manga haul!
It's a mini manga haul! It's like a really tiny one. So, first we have... This is volume 15 of Yone of the Dawn. Yes. Technically, the series itself, like the anime series, stops at volume 9. So I don't know why I haven't read it, because that's like 6 volumes right there of like things I could be reading.
I think we're waiting for it to sort of finish.
I still want it to like exist as an anime.
Yeah, well.
Christ.
Speaking of things that exist as anime.
I got volume 2 and volume 3 of Otakoi. Love is Hard for Otaku because I am complete trash for the show because it's amazing.
It's basically our marriage.
Yeah. It's basically about 4 people. They work for this corporation and they're all kind of trying to be subtle about the fact that they're all really...
Until
one of them outs the other.
And everybody gets outed.
It's amazing. I love that series so much. I'm desperate for season 2, so it better be happening.
Also, last plug for Yone. It's actually one of the best like fantasy
honestly, it's so good.
Out there where a girl tries to get her kingdom back after she gets betrayed by someone very important to her. Mm-hmm. And her only way to get her kingdom back is to reawaken the 4 other dragons that'll
which
help her.
Which is so exciting! Next is the UK edition of Nevermore, The Trials of Morgan Crow. And the reason why I got this one is A, I recently read and really enjoyed Nevermore, and B, you guys have to see this hardcover
because it's so pretty.
Flipping beautiful. Like
that
I'm just like
there's like gold flecks and stuff.
Like I don't even want to break the spine, but it's gorgeous. Nevermore is about this girl named Morgan Crow who is supposed to die on her 11th birthday, but instead of dying, she gets rescued by this dude named Jupiter North and taken to this place called Nevermore.
Jupiter North.
And once she's awesome, there, man. She's told that she has to compete in the trials to be entered into the Wonder Society as a member. And it's so much fun. Like, it's such a fun middle grade read, and it's also really whimsical. Mackie's definitely gonna have to read that at some point because I think he would truly.
I'm still stuck on Jupiter North, and do they call him Jupes?
And then I have 2 adult books. So, first is my favorite, Half Night Stand by Christina Lauren. I am not particularly fond of this cover. I do like the blue and the green. Oh, well, like yellow green. However, I bought it because it's Christina Lauren, and I have enjoyed pretty much every single one of their books that I've read, and they're always good when I need like a romantic comedy read, so I'm definitely hoping that that will be the case with this one. And this one is totally something I can blame on Instagram because everyone had it and then started
now
talking
you
about
have it,
and now I have it. It's called One Day in December by Josie Silver, and I honestly know nothing about it except that it is also a contemporary romance.
So now we go to the last part of the haul where it's the what we're complete trash for, so let's get Cassandra Clare out of the way.
Okay, let's all discuss Shadowhunter for like a quick, like a minute.
I'm the moron in this entire thing, like right now. I did not used to care, and now I do, and it's terrible and it's taken over my life.
But it's great though, because apparently it's gonna take over mine, so that's what I've been told.
And thus, behold, Alexa found Lady Midnight for like $5, which is, why not, right? It's in the same sort of cool format that we have our other books
yeah.
in, like the
paperback ones.
The paperback ones were cool, which is great. Apparently Alexa caved and bought the Shadowhunters
codex. It was at a good price, so I had to.
Also,
like how I just justified that.
Also a good price, and it's got nice, like, you know,
it's got all like the info about like Shadowhunter world.
And I guess this is of importance because everybody talks about the Shadowhunter Codex every so often. In fact, this features heavily in, I want to say, Inferno Devices, because one of the characters, you know, to learn about the Shadowhunters has to read the Shadowhunters Codex. So to actually have a very meta...
Is it your favorite?
Not the Codex.
No, but the character that has
the person
to read
who
it.
Read it. Okay, well, spoilers.
Oh, wait for it.
And finally, and I kindled this too, pre-ordered it and...
Well, technically, I am the one who ordered the hardcover because I caved.
And the only reason we ordered the hardcover is because it came with like really cool. What did it come with?
Illustrations.
Ta-da. Hey, these are new. Oh no, I know what this is. Okay.
Shh. But okay, the only thing we can show you that's probably not going to be spoiler because everyone has seen this, everyone and their mother is this.
Do you see how hard my heart is racing right now? That's how ruined my life is. I am angry at caring this much. I did not sign up to be this infested in everyone, and that's trying to keep it calm because I have to get through this. Just tears. By the way, I've read this thing and we'll talk about that eventually. But yes, welcome to Queen of Air and Darkness, which will sit quite nicely right next to our giant copy of Lord of Shadows.
All the first editions of Queen of Air and Darkness come with this beautiful, beautiful artwork on the cover. Also, I just really like the cover of Queen of Air and Darkness because the colors are so great.
And to anyone who read this on the first day that it came out and was left alone with all of your feelings because you were kind enough not to spoil everybody else, I feel for you so much.
While Maki recovers from being Shadowhunter's trash, While Maki recovers from his feelings about Queen of Air and Darkness, because I don't think you can recover after you become Shadowhunter's trash.
I hear the condition's terminal, so.
Yeah, pretty much. I have a tiny Harry Potter haul. First is this finished copy of The Crimes of Grindelwald, the second Fantastic Beasts movie. This is the screenplay, and it's got this lovely color, but what I really like about it is that it has a tiny Eiffel Tower on the hardcover.
Very magical.
So we actually went to see this movie the weekend it came out. We actually liked it a lot.
Interestingly enough. Like, we get the hate, but we just liked it anyway.
Yeah, and also Jude Law, so.
Oh, Jude Law.
I just have a soft spot for him and Eddie Redmayne. Okay, I'm not going to be able to pronounce this, but there was a very, very kind reader who decided to reach out and ask me if I want a Hawaiian version of the first Harry Potter book.
Oh, wow.
So she was kind enough to send it to me. Let me just say that it is the coolest thing ever that someone knows that I collect these first book in the series.
Well, that's so sweet.
In different languages. It's from Jennifer, who was so kind and sent this to me. I'm just like so excited because I love the fact that I am just like owning this book in all of these languages.
This is gorgeous. Thank you.
Speaking of people who are very generous, my friends Pat and Ian also traveled recently, and they also, whenever they travel, they try to remember to bring me a Harry Potter book. So we have one that is, I think, Turkish. I could be wrong because they went to Istanbul.
Ooh.
And then we have another one that's in Dutch. So clearly my friends know me very well. And last but not least, further proof
that I am
full of trash, basically. Obviously, I have the Kingdom of Ash UK edition by Sarah J Maas. This is the Waterstones exclusive edition because I'm trash and needed the fan art in it, even though I probably already have it in some other book. Kingdom of Ash is the final novel in the Throne of Glass series. I read it, I loved it, sobbed hysterically through most of it. So good. So great. I really love the series. I went to the tour stop for it, so we got this cool bag. Has the symbol of Terrison on it, and then it says the Kingdom of Ash tour on the back. There is exclusive artwork of Aelin, and then I have not one, not two, but I have three editions of Kingdom of
Ash. Tell them what the differences are, babe.
Because I am trash. So this one has fan art on the edges. That's Manon, and then got fan art on the back here with more people.
This looks like the
Also there was a pin in there.
Well, this looks like the Target version, which
Target version actually has a character card in it. It's at the back. I did not punch it out because why would I do that? Because I'd probably lose it.
Does anybody else want to punch that character out?
I don't know. Oh, a lot of people. And the Barnes & Noble exclusive edition has a poster on the inside. So hold.
Oh, that is gorgeous.
Hold.
Look at that.
My beautiful babies. Oh. I have a lot of feelings. Just kidding! I thought I only had three. Do you see how well I can keep track of my books? Those were the three like special editions. But also, I lied. I had one more. From going to the event, there was another one. Ta-da! This one has a page that basically says this is a special edition of the book from the 2018 World Tour. And I also have it signed. So that's great, obviously, because I love Sarah and I have for years. But also, we're not done yet with me being thrown up glass trash. Another thing that came out this year were the two collector's editions. So this is one of them. It does have this really cool sword on the cover. And it also still has like the bookmarker in it. And yeah, pretty. But this one, however, comes with a slipcase. The sword is on the back here, and then the front is thrown glass, and then you can pull it out using this ribbon. Ta-da! Also has the sword, but this time different. Oh, other way. There you go. The back is very similar, but also different. So, obviously I'm trash, so I ended up ordering both, and I will happily keep both for myself, because I'm trash again.
It's a lovely collection.
That is finally the end of this haul, thank God we finally made it.
Hooray! In any case, obviously...
That was our book haul, a massive one, considering we haven't done one in like a month and a half.
Right, absolutely. And plus I feel like... And we can start, like, you know, if anyone wants to start a support group for people who are emotionally scarred from all of the Shadowhunters books.
Can't be in that group yet.
Yet. Feel free to sign. I'll sign you up preemptively.
Everyone keeps telling me that I'm going to be Shadowhunters trash.
Well, those people are close to you and know what you are.
It's so, okay. We have this whole Shadowhunters thing planned, and you guys will find out in 2019.
Yes, you will. Happy to feel any comments. We, you know, we love talking to you guys.
I'm terrible at replying, but he's really great.
Form or fashion. So we also know how most of you who usually watch the channel feel about the Shadowhunters. So we're happy to talk about other things too.
Oh yeah, so, for sure.
Should that not be your?
We can talk about whatever you want in this book.
Just let us know, and we'll see you next time.
All right.